atmosphere. We had a gig at the dump, but nobody showed.
Wow.
It was a dump. We used to call those water hauls. Go do a gig, come back with nothing, it's a water haul. That's all you got was water out of it.
No, I mean the county dump.
Yeah.
We're gonna tell poetry to the people while they're unloading their trash.
There you go.
Fell through.
Fell through.
No, he's been recording this whole time.
No.
Yeah, that's a show.
Yeah.
Well, that's a wrap.
That's a wrap. Here, I'll give you this
after you.
Yeah, and then if I need to refresh, I just hit that.
That's it.
Where did they get that?
It's on video.
Track.
Yep, it's on video. Can't say video in Texas.
No laugh track.
I say video.
Video.
Video?
Video.
Does anybody have an extra capo?
Texas video.
No.
Don't.
There you go. Look at Jeff. Look at that guy go.
It's Randy right here.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Mary Beth and Randy, Susan Lundgren.
And I think, but I might not have to. I do not have to. Hell of a selection, thank you.
Take your pick, a pick.
Hell of a selection. Well, yeah, take your picks.
I think
that thing stays on video even after it goes off.
Or later.
Nice little road snack.
You know, it's got all this other stuff on here too, because they got an app, but I don't know what it does. Oh, it's slow-mo. And some other stuff too.
Yeah, I hope I don't hit those.
We won't get into that. Yeah, we'll be like,
yeah. I had to put them in the editing software and speed them up. There you go.
Welcome to Troubadour Roads. I'm Kathy Bauer.
And I'm Michael Broussard. And we showcase singer-songwriters, entertainers, and true Texas characters. And today we have Mr. Walt Perryman with us.
Yay.
And Jake McClain's joining us,
yes,
too.
And they're founders of the Snail Creek Outlaw Poetry Society.
Poet Society.
Poetry.
Oh,
either one.
Either one.
Either one.
Widely acclaimed, nationally criticized.
Nationally criticized. Yeah.
And we're so excited about having both of you on the show today. I have to say.
Absolutely.
Yes, we are. This is going to be a treat. We've been trying to get Walt over here.
We have for months now. Yeah.
Yeah.
But you know, he's so busy at Looking Buck.
I know.
He's got a lot of gigs.
Well, you do other things. You do parties and
he does
other things.
Well, I do other things. I go all over. I go past Looking Buck sometimes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Went to Stonewall the other day.
Went to Stonewall the other day.
No, I've been around several places. I go do my phone to some of the retirement centers and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Parties and stuff.
That's great, yeah.
But we do retirement centers too, and and it's always, it warms our heart to do
it. It's a blast,
like They really appreciate it. So that's cool. Yeah. You do that.
I haven't done it in a while, but I need to get back out there and do that some more.
Yeah.
I love that. We always start out the show with a song. We'll do that, and then we'll start talking to you guys and get everybody acquainted with you.
This is a song by Merle Haggard, and we just decided to turn it into a duet.
Yes, we did.
So here we go.
That is a long intro.
Okay,
that's not very.
There you go.
Somewhere between your heart and mine, there's a window that I can't see through. There's a wall so high that it reaches the sky somewhere.
Walt, you are a teller of true stories.
And he is.
And I am. They're all true, except two, and those two are pretty near true.
Okay. Well, you always start out before you perform and say these are true stories. And I think that's cool. And I love listening to them. There's some I've been hearing for, I think I've known you probably over 10 years.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, easy. And so I've heard a lot of stories.
You've heard a lot of true stories.
A lot of true stories, yeah.
Yes, yes.
And two that might not have been.
Okay, and two that might not, Pertmere, and we can, maybe you can say this is Pertmere true.
Okay.
And you're originally from Grand Falls.
Grand Falls, Texas, a little place way out west Texas. Born in Pecos, Texas, grew up in West Texas. In fact, what I like to do, so you, for the ones that don't know me, so you know who I am and where I'm coming from, I'm going to tell you my life story in 8 seconds. Are you ready?
We're ready.
I grew up in the West Texas oil field. I went to Saudi Arabia, spent 26 years with an oil company, came back with a wheelbarrow full of money, got the stock market, got divorced, and I still got the wheelbarrow.
Okay, but you were in Saudi Arabia working for an oil company?
For an oil company.
But were you in the service also?
No, not over there. I just drilled wells over there. I was in the drilling department, drilled wells over there for 26 years. And it was quite an experience. There were a lot of Americans over there at the time, and probably not so much anymore. But
right.
I guess I would have stayed over there longer, but there's too many, you know, wealthy enough over there, you know. So I came home and came to Lukenbach, and I just lived out here in the hill country.
Yeah, what brought you to Lukenbach? Did somebody say, hey, come out to Lukenbach, or do you just went out there on your own?
Well, I went to Frankenburg here, and I didn't even go out there for about a year and a half. And I went out there, I just fell in love with it. And I took 3 guitar lessons so I could learn how to play guitar and play with the big boys. My 3 guitar lessons didn't work, so I started telling stories so I could get some attention out there, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've been doing that ever since. Yeah.
That's me. When I moved here in 98, I didn't go out to Lukenbach. I didn't really... I knew of it, but I didn't go out there. And then I was at Hondo's, and Doug Davis was there, and he's like, you should come out to Lukenbach. And I'm like, oh, okay. And that's what got me hooked, and I was there 4 or 5 nights a week, and that was when Dale was playing his Bicker Circle.
They couldn't kick you out.
And I just was there at the show. It's very addictive, you know, it is, and I was out there almost every night. Loved it. And it was always a treat when you showed up with your little puppy.
Oh, yeah, my little dog.
Yeah, your little dog. For years, she was with you. Part of your show, I think.
Yeah, she was. She went over. I mean, people knew her before they knew me.
Honey?
Yeah, honey dog.
Yeah, she's
we had a lot
sweet.
Of fun out there.
Yeah.
Actually, I went out there about almost 17 years ago to drink a beer, and I never left, so. I only got there one time, really. I was up there the other day, and someone said, Walt, have you lived here all your life? I said, well, not yet. Working on it. Working.
Give me some time, man.
And Jake McClain, are you from here?
No, I've been here about 12 years, probably.
Yeah.
Yeah. From Galveston area.
Galveston, really? Yeah.
I grew up in Lake City.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Well, I used to live in Santa Fe.
I went to school in Pearland.
Oh, wow. Okay.
For a while.
Didn't even realize that they're from the same stopping grounds.
That's right.
Yeah, that's cool.
It's the center of the universe here.
Yes.
It seems to be. Every time we go somewhere, she meets somebody from Lake City.
Yeah, it's weird. I won't talk to anybody in the audience, and then all of a sudden I'll go, where are you guys from? They'll go, Lake City? And I'm like, you're kidding me. Because I don't always ask.
Yeah.
It's something.
But I'm like you. I came up to Lukenbach and saw him. It was pretty good experience. I've been hooked ever since.
There you go,
Walt
one of his
like
proteges. You've been trying to teach me the ropes on poetry and whatnot.
Yeah.
So did he get you into poetry? You were already a poet.
No, he got me into poetry.
He did get you into it. That's cool.
He's got over 20 poets that I know of.
Really?
Probably all.
Yeah.
Y'all remember one down that birthday party he had? Remember that? At a birthday party and all these poets.
Oh,
people
I missed the birthday
party. Oh,
yeah.
It's pretty cool.
I'm sorry. And they just had it, right? February is your birthday?
Yeah.
That's right. It was just your birthday.
Yeah.
It was several years ago when we did that.
30 years young.
Yeah. You're pretty close.
Pretty close.
Well, you want to start us off with maybe one of your stories?
Yeah. I got a couple of ones I'll just kind of share with you. But this one is about a woman's body parts. That's not what you think. I'm a man and often think of a woman's body parts. Lately I've been thinking about their hands and their hearts. After years of use, their hands start getting pretty rough from working, raising kids, and all that housewife stuff. Their hands are driven by another body part, and that would be from a good woman's loving heart. Their parts work better when they are treated right. Unless nurtured with love, she got some parts that would even fight. When woman's parts are working properly, it's a better life. I'm talking about all women, not just a girlfriend or a wife. Everyone may not understand what this poem is about, but I bet some of you women out there will figure it out. Thank you.
Yeah.
Is that new?
I wrote it a long time ago.
I've never heard it. Yeah.
I hadn't heard that one yet.
And speaking of women, I think this, do you have three daughters?
Yes, I
have. The reason I mention it is I have three daughters. He has something in common.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay. Three daughters. I have a son also, but I saw you had three daughters. I'm like, wow. No wonder you have such an insight to
women. Well, I was raised. my mother passed away when I was young, and Dad raised me and two brothers.
Uh-huh.
So I grew up without a woman, and then I got married and had four in the house.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I know. My son can relate. He knows everything about women, my son, because
yeah.
He's the baby. And he had me and three.
I don't know if he knows everything.
Well, but I've said this at other times that he's, I'll say it again. He's kind of he likes women with hips. And that's because he grew up with three women with boobs. So we think that's why he went with the hip thing. He's seen enough breasts to last him forever.
No offense, Caitlin. No offense at all.
No offense, Caitlin. But he goes for women with, you know, with hips.
Yeah.
We think that's why, because we don't have.
I have a poem about that, I think.
Yes. Breasts.
Hopefully, yes.
He's got a poem about everything.
It's about women. My mother passed away when I was 9. My dad raised me and two brothers, and we made just fine. So I grew up in a house without a woman. The time I thought was pretty cool. About the only time I ran a female was when I went to school. So I didn't know very much about women, like I just said. When I was 19, I fell in love, and soon we were wed. When I was 20, I thought I knew all about a woman that could possibly be known. Until we had three daughters and had to raise them until they were grown. But raising them three daughters turned me into a nervous wreck. I could taste the stories about the hair standing up on the back of your neck. Now, a certain time of the month thing, I knew nothing about my first 19 years. The four women in the house at a certain time of month can turn them into tears. There's panting hoses hanging all over the place. They spend hours and hours just putting on their face. Then there come a time in life I guess all fathers hate. That's when little girls first begin to date. When they started dating, I would just go into an angry rage. But my fear was what the board was that they were with, like I was when that was their age. But now I set my little empty nest. You know, I hear the girls in the house. It really was my very best. Thank you.
I feel that way too. Good. I actually miss those years when my kids were little. I'd like to just go back there and hug their necks a little more.
Yes.
But yeah, you do miss them being young. So Jake, he got you into writing poetry, but you also write songs. You write songs.
That's right.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'll do
sing
one
now.
It's the one I wrote all the time. Live life young, wild, and free. Nothing but time in my pocket. Now time is catching up to me. Looking out that window behind me, I had to close my reflection in the glass.
Watch all you want from the future. Time is gaining on you fast.
I was interested in writing from fourth grade, but not poetry, like stories. And
yeah.
And do some writing contests and that kind of
stuff. Short stories, yeah.
So you kind of were creative already.
I got third place in a writing competition one time about a night or something, and that kind of got me going.
Yeah.
I didn't really get started until I met this guy, because I figured if he could do it.
What about you, Walt? Were you a little boy writing stories, or when did that happen for you?
Actually, I did start when I was little, but I never shared them with anybody, because when I was going to school, that was not the macho thing to do.
Yeah.
And then when I went overseas, I meant a little bit, but I didn't really start doing it until I came back here and tried to do something looking about, so I started telling my stories, and people seemed to like them, so I just...
How old were you when you went to Saudi Arabia?
I was 28 years old.
28? And then you wrote some over there?
Yeah, I wrote some over there.
I thought I read something that you wrote, since you told stories to the guys over there. Did you? Your working partners? Or?
What I used to tell them over there, some.
Yeah, growing up.
People out on grilling rigs and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Been a long time ago, so now I'm just writing. We got poems about growing up, or a little kid, into getting old.
Right.
And a lot of stuff in between. Just tell a story of my life, but I try to make it rhyme.
We just have the neatest way of saying stuff, like even on Facebook daily.
You'll have dedicated writer.
Yeah. Every day. Every day is something. Yeah. That's cool. But like, I can remember first getting in front of people and singing, a little nervous. And I was real young, you know, when I started making, I forced people to listen. Sit down, I want you to hear me sing. So I was that kind of, I was out there.
Sit down, I want you to hear me sing.
I wanted an audience. I always wanted an audience. But were you like that? Were you nervous like the first time you read something that you wrote? And it's a lot of it's so personal, you know?
Yeah, I always was real loud. I guess I demanded their attention.
Yeah.
Because I built it out.
Yeah.
You know, I did that, I guess, so somebody could understand me better, because I do have a West Texas slang, I guess.
Yeah.
In fact, yesterday I told old Tom Murray, you know Tom Murray?
Uh-huh.
I've been thinking about what tomorrow I'm going North Avenue to look at some oil wells. And Tom Murray, I said, "Are you going to go with me tomorrow? I'm going to go look at some wells." He said, "Sure, I'm going to go with you." So we talked about 2 or 3 minutes there. And then just finally he said, "Where do they keep them?" And that's not true. He thought they were about wells in the ocean. I'm talking about
sea world
whales. You're talking about,
we're going to Hawaii.
Mammal
whales. Oh, they keep them everywhere.
Well, I knew there was something wrong with the conversation, because There must be a ball well somewhere. They're where they are.
They're where they are.
You can talk about half an hour and they'd be on the same page.
But I think your accent works for you. I think doing your poetry, it just works for you. If you didn't have that accent, it wouldn't probably be as funny sometimes.
Yeah, thank you.
It works for you. I love your stuff. I like the one about the lights in the town being so small.
Yeah.
That's one that I brings to mind that I liked a lot that you do.
Yeah.
It's a good one. You
want to
do it?
Do that.
Okay, I like that one.
But I just painted first Grand Falls, a small town out in West Texas. Not much there. I mean, years ago we had a red light. Now the red light's gone. There's not much there anymore. But for poem's sake, Fort Stockton is 32 miles south. And I swear this is a true story about me not red light. I was growing up back in Grand Falls back in 1958, walking to my grandmother's house, and it was getting mighty late. And I only liked about four blocks to be at my destination. There was a transport truck pulling out from Mr. Hale's service station. There's no other cars and no one in sight, so I jumped on back that truck. It's going to get off down the red light. Well, I was hanging on back that truck, and I began to have some fear. It seemed to increase every time that driver shifted to a higher gear. Well, look at my face, probably be anything you've ever seen. When I picked up that tank and I saw a red light, it was green. How fast were we going? I'm not really sure. The lights been falling with nothing but a blur. I should have been in my grandmother's house, maybe tucked into my bed, but I was hanging on back this truck going to Fort Stockton instead. So I climbed along that tanker. I was holding on real tight. Had to stop that driver before Grand Falls was out of sight. I didn't know this driver. I didn't mean him any harm. The airplane went to heck when I tapped him on the arm. At the same time, I stuck my face to the window so I could be sure he heard what I was saying. I know Jerome was touching when he jerked around his head. Now, I never seen a man that close up. I'm quite as scared as he. Guess he had too much because he gave some to me. That driver hit the brakes and he went into a skid. Now it's time he's screaming some really bad cuss words at this little kid. So hit the ground or run in because that meant he wanted to fight. I don't know why he's mad at me, not that dang red light. I ran all the way back to my grandmother's house and I thought tired I couldn't talk. But from that night on, I could be safer. So I just walk. And that's a true story.
Yeah.
Okay, there's one you do that makes me kind of sad. It's the little dog that gets
little puppy dog.
Yeah, it's kind of sad, but
it's
kind of
sad.
It's a good one.
But, you know, everybody remembers the first puppy dog we lost. I guess it gets kind of bad in the middle, but before he throw rocks at me, he let me finish up, and he comes out not too bad. This another two-story fixing unfold. Happened out in West Texas when I was about 6 years old. One time I had a brand new little puppy. That puppy was solid black. It was my grandmother's house. Me and puppy was out in the back. Well, I decided I'd go down and sell some empty soda bottles and buy myself a candy bar. I was going down to Miss UW's store. It wasn't very far. So I found a long piece of cotton rope, and it was good and strong. So I tied my puppy neck so he could come along. I'm walking down the street, got my puppy on a rope and my bottles in a sack. I heard something coming, but I didn't look back. This man come by in a black pickup truck. Puppy darted out, must have run out of luck. That old boy run my puppy. My puppy made a splat. It was hit and run. That old man just kept it going. Left my puppy flat. Sat there and crying, I still hold the rope. I'd never let it go. Started dragging my old puppy back to grandmother's house, and I was feeling pretty low. My puppy was in a trail of blood, and I was feeling sick. And my poor little puppy, well, it wasn't really thick. I buried that puppy out by grandmother's clothesline pole. I remember, didn't have to dig a very deep hole. Now, I never did figure out who was in the right or who was in the wrong. I don't know if I meant too close or my rope was too long. But it's been over 60 years since I lost a little puppy of mine. I'm gonna be okay. I just need a little more time.
Is that a true story?
Yes, it's true. Yeah, it's true.
That's kind of sad.
I've been taking him back and showing him where it got run over at.
Really? Oh.
I saw the red light and everything.
Oh, really?
Miss you dailies.
That's cool. Mm-hmm. That's neat. We did a show with Stephen K. Morris on Sunday, and he was talking about stories, your stories.
Yeah.
And he said, I've got one. He told your story about the miniature horse.
A miniature horse.
Yeah, he did.
Yes, and he gave you credit and said, this is one that you tell. And
yep.
Yeah, you want to tell that one?
Well, I'm glad he could remember all the words to it.
It's a long one.
It's one I wrote about miniature horses, but you got to think about it. You know, it's food for thought. Miniature horses. Why? Thank you very much.
Yes, he did. So you're getting talked about even though you're not,
oh my God,
not around. But that's cool. We have a few people that listen. They're regular listeners. We have a lot of listeners, but these are some regular ones. Yep. Susan Lundgren.
Yep. Crosscut Music.
Crosscut Music, yep. And she tells where everybody's playing on hers. You might go to that and join her page. Yep. And she loves it. And she was telling people early this morning that you were going to be here
that's
today.
Right.
Oh, wow.
That she knew would love
well,
it.
I joined her page.
She's you a did? Fan, yeah.
And Monica Albeder from Elma Lovers, we met her there, and she yep. listens faithfully every week. And Mary Beth.
Randy and Mary Beth.
Brown, they are yeah. also, they listen every week. And we like those listeners. And we have new listeners sign up for it on our page daily.
All the time. Yeah, thank you guys.
Road,
so. Thank you all for listening. And send us a message if you feel prompted to, and we'll respond.
Yeah. Anyway, how about another song? Do you have another one, or even a poem?
Let's see, I'll do this one I wrote about Walt. It's a couple of his ex-girlfriends.
This is a song about wow. Walt?
Yeah.
His ex-girlfriends?
Friends. Yeah.
A long time ago.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Heavy on friends.
It's called Now I'm Afraid That She'll Never Go. Well, sometimes I love her and sometimes I don't. Sometimes she will, sometimes she won't. We got into a fight and she started to cry. Slapped me on the face and told me goodbye. But she came back to live with me once again. It was the saddest that I've ever been. I should have never told her that I love her so. Cause now I'm afraid that she'll never go. Now I'm afraid that she'll never go. I wish to God I'd learned to say no. I like my poetry and I drink my beer. And if she don't like it, wish she'd get out of here. Once my cabin was a happy little home. Just me and my dog free to roam. But my dog ran away whenever she moved in. Rather live with my dog than my new girlfriend. Now I'm afraid that she'll never go. I wish to God I'd learned to say no. I like my buddies and I drink my beer. Get out of here. If she don't like it, she can get out of here.
There you go. It's a love song.
It is a love song. You know, it's cool. Y'all have kind of a bond friendship. I didn't know that. And I know both of you. But that's cool.
Yeah.
You've got
that's
a good
song.
Friend in Walt, I'm sure, because yes. he's a great guy. So.
Oh, yeah.
You know, we have a lot.
I slept on his couch a lot.
Good song, man. And you can. You can find that song at Snail Creek Outlaw Poet Society.
Yeah.
Just look them up and go there.
Now, if you have a book, right? You have several books, or
no? I only have a CD, but I read all
three
now. But if, I had three made and I lost one, sold one, and I got one left.
How does someone go about getting a CD at Walt?
They can Facebook me, or just Walt Perryman, or you know, email waltperryman@hotmail.com. $15 and I'll send it to you.
Okay.
There you go.
Very good. Yeah, how many poems do you think are on it?
Oh, I've got probably 18, something
yeah.
like that.
Yeah.
Quite a few.
Yeah.
Awesome. Walt Perryman, P-E-R-R-Y-M-A-N.
And most of the time you can find me at Luckenbach.
I'm up there about 8 days a week.
Yeah.
And Walt is married.
That's where we're at.
Your very sweet wife, Laura.
Yes, I got married about a year and a half ago, and she's really been good to me.
Yeah,
good.
She's a very
Things
sweet,
just
pretty lady. Really good
right now.
Yeah, good deal.
Keeps you in line.
Yeah.
She does that. Yes, she does.
Keeps
your ducks in a row. But I needed
kept in line.
Does she ever get nervous that you might write some kind of poem?
You never get in a battle of wits with a poet.
Right, yeah. There you go. Yeah.
Now she knows I'm scared too.
Yeah.
Right? That's funny.
I love it.
I noticed you have some other poems in your hand, maybe something I haven't heard. It's,
this one, a long time ago, it's How to Love.
Oh, okay.
Seems we spend our life trying to love, be loved, and be happy. But it seems like dogs know how to do this, even when they're a little puppy. A puppy loves you right from the very start, and he loves you for your life with all of its heart. Dogs can show love by licking or wagging their tails. So often we do not show our love, and it often fails. Dogs may not live as long as me and you. They give a lot more love in less time, too. We can learn a lot from our dogs about living, like unconditional love and a lifetime of giving. Dogs may be dumb. Their love is so true. I guess we are too smart to love like they do. Had you rather be dumb with a happy heart or be unhappy because you're too smart? A hug, a smile, and the words, I love you. I don't think it's such a dumb thing to do.
That's good.
That's so true.
Yep.
Yeah. Those little dogs.
That's right.
I mean, you are their whole world.
You are.
You got to think about that. I have to remind myself of our dogs.
Yeah, because you know? I watch our dogs follow Kathy everywhere.
Yeah.
They hate me.
They would be right here by my feet. I mean, they just do that. Yeah. It's automatic. You know, if I go in another room, they go in another room.
It's like a train. Watch it go through the house.
They're little miniature Australian shepherds.
Oh.
Yeah, and they are very protective. I mean, well, they were there before him.
Yeah.
So that's
I'm an outsider.
That's their thing. And Pixel actually bit Michael the first time he came over.
Yeah.
That's sweet.
Yeah, wasn't that sweet?
She's real quick.
Well, you must come back.
You did. She bites and then runs and gets on the couch. And it's so quick, you're not sure that she really bit somebody.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's I never saw her move. I looked back.
The heels?
Do what?
She gets you in the heels.
She
nails you in the calf.
Yeah. And she'll get you and be on the couch.
She was on the couch, and I thought, I think your dog just bit me. She goes, really? And I'm like, yeah, I really do think so.
And he looked, and she had.
Sure enough.
She's very quick.
Yeah. But she's loved me ever since.
Yeah, she has. Yeah, so she learned that he's okay. But at first, you know, she's a real good judge of character a lot of times, you know.
So you're saying I was bad?
Well, no, I'm not saying you were bad, but sometimes, like, people come over and they've ended up not being very nice people. And I'm like, yeah, you call that.
Yeah.
Jake been over there?
Jake been over there.
Yeah, I got bit, too.
Yeah, Jake got bit also. Both of them bit him on the back.
Yep.
Yeah, he's bit all of our musician friends.
Yes. Jake did this song, and when we first met Jake, he was playing bass. He played me bass on
stand-up
bass.
I was just thinking
bass.
About that.
And he did a song, and you didn't write it, but who was it? Brian, John? Who was it? That, you know what song I'm talking about?
Well,
and we loved it.
I heard him do a Townes Van Zandt song.
Maybe that was
what
it.
I'm thinking of was to Live is to Fly.
That's it, Townes Van Zandt.
Yeah.
Do you still do that song?
Sure.
It was so beautiful, and that was the first time we heard you sing, first time we met you,
first
and
time
we're
I
like,
met you,
oh,
played that song, and
so
I thought,
pretty.
I like this guy.
It impressed us.
What you know today is
Townes Van Zandt's birthday.
Oh, yeah. Perfect then.
Yeah, sure
that's right.
So I will definitely do that song.
Okay.
So yeah,
this is the
do a song for Towns.
Yeah. This is the Guy Clark version.
That's what I remembered him saying.
Yeah.
Thank you.
days up and down they come, like rain on a conga drum, getting most remember some. Don't turn none away, everything is not enough, nothing is too much to bear. Where you've been is good and gone, all you keep is the getting there. To live and fly, both low and high. Shake the dust off of your wings, sleep out of your eyes. Goodbye to all my friends, it's time to go again. Here's to all the poetry and the picking on down the line. I'll miss the system here, bass is low and the treble clear. It don't pay too much to think on the things you leave behind. Here's to fly, oh, those holes are all that's real. Some fall on you like a storm, and sometimes you dig your own. The choice is yours to make, time is yours to take. Some sail upon the sea, and some toil upon the storm.
Friends of mine were playing at Lickenbach. Went over there to say hi to them when they were loading in, and I saw you dragging the bass across the walkway.
Yeah, that's not an easy
instrument
to pick up like the bass ukulele or something.
It reminds me of the days when they used to put them on top of the cars and drive across the
country. It's hard not to abuse them a little bit.
Yeah.
I want to put some mud grips on it and just dolly it.
There you go. Like a wheelbarrow.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Looking at you to say, I thought we'd get another point from Walt.
Well, you know, I got several about computers, but you know, this one that you never heard is called Logging On.
Logging On.
Computer story.
Password and all that stuff.
Right?
I have a photographic memory, but the picture is kind of dim. I guess that's because it's never been loaded to film. I can't remember passwords, and it's driving me insane. I can't remember any of them, and they're all the same. Sometimes I write it down and put it where it's easy to find. Later, when I can't find it, it just blows my little mind. Then a little security question come on the screen. When I can't answer them, it's when I start to scream. Then the stupid puzzle security images come into sight. Then I'm locked out when I cannot guess them right. Then when I am backed up and I'm back against the wall, I pick up the phone and make the help call. Now, I wish I could be a hacker, but I'm not smart enough. Heck, I can't even hack into my own bank. computer just don't get it.
Me either, and I hate that password thing. Because I'll write them down somewhere, and then I can't remember where I wrote it to go find it.
Oh, I know.
It drives me nuts.
And I write them down. I got them written all over the house.
Yeah.
It's my one final one. They can find it.
I think a hacker could.
I know, it drives me
hacker
crazy.
Hacker could find it.
Yeah, I have several emails I can't ever get back into because I can't figure out how to get back into them. And
it takes a hard up hacker to hack some poetry, you know what I mean? You gotta be really hard up for some.
You do.
But
that's true.
But when you can't hack into your own stuff.
I know. And you have to have a password for everything you do Yep. Anything, you know, if it's just a shop, you know, you have to have a password to get into it, you know.
Yeah, he told me that you wrote this big story one time and you hit some button and it all went away, so you wrote it down on a big chief tablet and then logs back in and the story comes right back.
It's like, why do I need that tablet?
Yeah, I got that one too.
That poem? That is a poem, isn't it?
About computers.
Yeah,
that's a good one, too. It's so true. It just, and the working out one is so true. I like that one, too.
Okay, this is about computers. Me and my computer don't get along very good, and I don't think we ever will. Right now, I think I got a virus. I don't know where to stick the pill. The other day, I wrote a big, long story, and it took me all day. And hit a wrong button and my story went away. When that stuff disappears, where does it go? If I would have Bill Gates' phone number, I would have called him and see if he might know. And about 3 days later, I hit another key. That story I lost, it all come back to me. But too late, I had written my story with paper and pen. I don't guess I'll ever know where my lost story has been. Sometimes I log on to surf the net, check my email. Not very long before some connection will fail. I was in there looking about here just the other night. Some of my boys said, Walt, did you ever Google yourself? We almost got in a fight. But they said if you had computer problems, best thing to do is just boot it. Well, folks, I'm thinking about getting out my 357 and I just shoot it. I paid a bunch of money for some kind of computer protection. At least I get it works when I hit about 6 rounds of injection. I don't guess I'll be known as Walt the computer nerd. Right now I don't care if I ever type in another password. I've had the computer, I'm finally drawing the line. From here on out, a big cheap front tablet and a cigar box will do me just fine.
It's crazy, isn't it? We live kind of out in the country. And
oh, man.
It's frustrating because our phone service.
Yeah.
Like, the phone will ring and I'll see somebody's calling, but I can't answer it because
yeah.
I won't be able to talk to them. It's frustrating. You run in and out, and you go outside in the rain, and you're standing there. And,
that's
like,
right.
Oh, it's so frustrating. And we, our business is the phone.
Yeah.
You know, doing gigs. And
so we come to town just to conduct business.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we stay home.
Sometimes we drive in just to use the phone. It's frustrating.
Well, what bad if you lose your phone, then you don't have any numbers at all.
That's right.
And you don't
know.
And you can't call anybody and make their name phone booth anymore.
Yeah. I know. It's real frustrating. Sometimes I miss the days of not having, because this is why, let's say you don't want to talk to somebody and they're calling you. They know you know. They call.
Yeah.
And I don't like that. It's kind of invading my privacy. Like, I don't want to call them back and I don't want to talk. But they know that I saw they called. And so it kind of, you don't have that privacy, you don't have that, if you don't answer it, you're in trouble, you know.
So you don't want them to know that you know.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's like, there's been times when I haven't had a phone, it'll be broke or something, and I'm kind of glad. I think, oh yeah, I get a whole day of no phone.
You
got
to really take advantage
of that thing. Yeah.
And you remember the days when you had to memorize everybody's number?
Yeah.
Even your own?
Now you don't have
Now I have no clue.
Yeah.
You don't remember that when you were riding about the roadside park, you know?
Well, as a poem, we know it, but as far as on the song, there's that one line that finished up.
Y'all co-write and write together?
Well,
that's awesome.
Yeah, that's great.
You want to try it and do it anyway?
Just get as far as you can?
Yeah, go as far as you can.
I'll go as far as you can. Just one line where I work.
Well, I stopped off at the roadside bar to answer nature's call. Well, I walked in the bathroom, there was only one empty stall. Just as I sat down, the voice said, "How are you doing today?" Well, I guess I'm pretty friendly, so I said, "I'm doing okay." Said I'm going hunting, hope I give me a deer. Said look, I'm going looking, back, I'm gonna drink myself some beer. He said, "Honey, I'm in the bathroom, I'll have to give you another call. Every time I try to talk to you, someone answers from the next stall." See, I'm from the old school, no way I could have known. Talking to me, he was talking on the phone. So now when I go to the restroom and I find I'm not alone, always holler down the line, said you won't have a phone. Yeah. Yeah. I was driving home one night from Odessa to San Antonio. I stopped off at a roadside park, someone called me on the phone. Just as I sat down, I said, "How are you doing today?" A voice from the stall beside me said, "Guess I'm doing okay." I told him I'm from the old school, no way I could have known. People, they ain't talking to me, they're talking on the phone. And I find I'm not alone. Always holler down the line.
Anybody got a phone?
Yeah, yeah, so man. True. It's so embarrassing when somebody say, "Hey, how you doing?" And you think they're talking to you, and you answer, and you realize they got a phone in their hand. And you feel like
and that's a true story.
Yeah. Oh man, it's so silly.
It's they got the thing in their ear. You know, they're going around talking to themselves. I think they're talking to me.
I do too.
Yeah. Yeah, some little girls in there talking to them, I think she's talking to me.
Yeah. And they give you that look like,
yeah.
Yeah. Oh, it's just, oh, I hate that too. I think it should be outlawed to be on the phone in the store. Because I don't want to hear their conversation. It's invading my space. Yeah. I don't want to hear them talking. Tell the story about Dairy Queen that day.
Oh, that was
funny.
We were in Dairy Queen one day eating lunch, and this older couple came up and sat down next to us, and she got her phone out and she put it on speakerphone, and you could hear it dialing somebody. And Kathy goes, "That's a little loud," isn't it? I said, "Yeah, well, don't worry about it, you know, it'll probably be just quick." So they got on the phone together and started talking about. She goes, "Well, how'd your doctor visit go?" She said, "Well, good. They drew some blood."
What?
She went on to tell us about the illness and everything else. And I'm thinking, well, I didn't know if I wanted this hamburger anyway.
Yeah, I was like, don't they realize that you're eating lunch and you don't want to hear about a doctor visit?
Yeah, but people, I think, just get confused about the fact that they realize other people are around listening.
Yeah.
I love how when they catch you in these drunken moments and then that on Facebook.
Yeah, that's right. There's a camera on you all the time. I mean, with phones, you know, Luckenbach, you gotta
be careful.
They always get me in my fat mode when I'm scrunched over in my muffin top is showing.
God, this guitar make me look fat.
Now, Jeff knows about that.
Yeah, Jeff knows all about that.
That ended his
Let's
marriage.
Let's not get him involved. Yeah. He's trying to stay
after that about four Lunaritas.
Oh.
Like bad dancing.
Yeah.
I hate that too.
Mine's buzzing. You don't mind if I get this phone call?
No, go right ahead.
Go ahead.
Go right ahead.
Okay. I'm sorry, just take a second.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
Hello? Is this the U.S. Agriculture Department in Washington, D.C.? Thanks for turning my call. My name is Walt Perryman. I'm down here in Luckenbach, Texas. My buddy T-Bob is on 1376. You got a check for your department for $1,000 to not raise hogs. See, I'm thinking about going out being about not raising them hogs. I think I can not raise hogs pretty good, you know what I mean? I got a few questions about your program there, if you don't mind. What kind of farmers best not raise them where hogs on? Yeah? Was there a certain breed of hog you don't raise? You cannot raise any old hog. Well, I want you to not raise them hogs in Lugenbach, but I don't care if you have to not raise them somewhere else. Yeah? Well, here's my question here. If I can get $1,000 for not raising 50 hogs, can I get $10,000 for not raising 500? No, I don't get too big too fast not doing this sort of thing, you know what I mean? Oh, that sounds good, though. But he's about to tell you a program not raise corn, so I wonder if I qualify not raise them hogs, if I qualify not raise that corn, I'm not going to feed them hogs, I'm not going to raise. Really? Wow, you're going to get my vote next time around there. That sounded great. Well, T-Bob sure liked your program. He said, makes more money now since you don't raise hogs. And indeed, we did raise hogs. Had more time than right beer and looking by. Yeah. Well, say, since I'm going to this business, I'm going to quit my job and go into unemployment. How long does that last? Really? Wow. You got any cheese? Hello? Hello?
Oh,
hung up. And that is just pert near true right there.
That's pert near true.
You live in Lugenbach, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's considered Lugenbach.
He's one of the three.
Yeah, you're one of the three. And you have some cabins, right? You built
some
cabins?
Yes, I do have a two B&B type cabins. Where not bed and breakfast, more like bed and beer. But
you bring both.
Yeah, you bring both.
You bring both. Right?
You bring the bed.
Beer.
Yeah.
Your truck bed.
1 mile from Lugenbach.
There's no cabins.
And you're welcome to them. Give me a call. Walt, Perryman, 830-992-9502.
Yeah.
I'll see if I can line you up or whatever. It's a short drive to Lugenbach.
Yeah, I've seen the entrance. It's really,
they're
really
nice.
Cute.
Yeah, they are nice.
Yeah.
They're real nice.
They look nice. Nice. Yeah. I was going to call you one day and say, hey, can I move in it?
Sure.
How long is long term?
Just bring your bed and your beer.
Yeah, bring your beer.
Well, I've learned if you get out of there by 5 a.m., he never even knows you were there.
Oh.
Oh. Is that a fact?
You know, y'all could just be the Snail Creek Outlaws and leave it at that.
Yeah,
but we can't. We've got too many members.
Oh, yeah.
It's a secret society now.
It's a society now.
So just me and you.
Oh, you didn't know about those other ones? I thought they were your friends.
If you want to be a member of that, you can look that up and become a slug.
We've got quite a few members. Cherokee Jack Swim is one. Dave Williams is another. We've got quite a few.
People are finding out about it and getting into the poetry. And
We'd like to be honorary members.
Yeah, I'd like to be.
We need as many of those as we can get.
Okay, well then we're in.
Yeah. How's your driving record?
Well, let's not go there.
You got a driver's license?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, we have driver's license.
They gave me one.
We need a driver.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Come on out slugging.
We're both good on driving.
Yeah, we're both good on
drivers. Yeah, let us know. You want to go check out some whales?
Yeah.
We can drive you to them.
Whales or whales.
Whales or whales.
Yeah.
I don't think you keep too many of them in West Texas.
There's probably more snails than whales.
There's sand whales.
We've really enjoyed having you guys today. It's
absolutely
been such a treat. I knew it would be Walt and
Jake. We've enjoyed it too. Thank you so much for that.
Yeah. And if you want to get some of Walt's CDs, go to Walt Perryman at Hotmail.
At
Hotmail.com and get some of those. You'll love it. And Jake, you can see these guys, Jake McClain and Walt Perryman at Lugenbach, about what, 8 days a week?
Yep.
Yeah, in fact, Jake's hosting out there tonight.
Oh, are you really?
Tuesdays and March and
April. I'm dadgum.
All right.
5 o'clock, so.
Well, that sounds like fun.
That's always a fun gig.
Yeah. Oh, it is. It is very fun.
Yeah.
It's a good time.
We like
the weather's perfect, so we'll be outside.
You bet.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah, absolutely. So go by and see that if you're in town, for sure, in Fredericksburg or Lugenbach or anywhere near.
That means your partner will be there too,
right?
Yeah,
some of the Snail Creek
Society
members could drop in at any time.
You know, I bet it'd be a really cute T-shirt. I mean, think about that logo with the snail and
it.
Yeah,
it'd be really cute. Yeah, I'm all about the T-shirt.
Yeah.
I've never seen a cute snail either.
Well, you can make him kind of cartoonish, you know, kind of cute.
Yeah.
Little stubby fat little thing.
Like a Geico guy?
Yeah, you can make him, you know, cartoonish.
Will a picture of Jake do?
Well,
yeah,
you could put a picture of Jake, you know, but that'd work.
He could have your hat.
Don't you? Yeah. I'm more like a snail without a shell right now, so you might want to pick one that's got a shell.
Snail without claws.
Yeah, because snails without shells, they're not too pretty.
They're called slugs. Yeah.
They're not real pretty, I will give you that.
Yeah.
Yeah, those slugs aren't very pretty. But if you'd like to take us out, do you have something that might be a favorite of yours in your body of work?
Well, you know what? I got one last one I have to share with you. It's here lately, everybody knows what the peace officer been going through.
Right.
Yeah, there's been times in my life I didn't care to see them and all that kind of stuff. But our peace officers are going through a lot right now. They're getting ambushed, they're getting all that stuff.
True.
Listen, thank all the peace officers for the job that you do and for the sacrifice you make wearing the blue. You put your lives on the line at work every day. You do it to help and protect us. And I know it's not for the pay. You are a trained professional to do what you do and persecuted for doing what they taught you. A street thug can fight and cuss and spit in your face, yet you're scrutinized for spraying him with mace. If you shoot someone that is shooting at you, why are you asked? Did you really have to? Peace officers are being ambushed almost every day, so thanks for showing up and risking your lives anyway. And the worry and anguish your family goes through, all because you're a policeman doing what you do. And to the officers that have died and sacrificed all, and the silence that comes after their last radio call.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very good.
Nice.
Yeah. Very nice.
Yep, we appreciate having y'all.
Well, thank y'all so much. We enjoyed it.
Very much, and we'll see you next week on Troubadour Row. We've got Bobby E. Boyd, let me rephrase that, Bobby E. Boyd from Nashville, Tennessee, and his band Cattle will be with us next week on Tuesday at 2 on Troubadour Road, and we'll see you then. Bye-bye. Good deal.
That was fun.
That was fun, man.
I didn't think so.
That.
I knew you'd make it, Walt. You just got nervous for nothing.
I knew you'd make it.
Yeah, if you don't.
It didn't go too bad.
Great.
Good.
No, it was
okay.
That was perfect. Thank you, Walt.
Thank you all
for your stuff.
I'd like to get settled in.
I always have.
Always will.
I'm going to put recording. Hang on.
Thank you.